Welcome to DivCasts from University of Chicago Divinity School. For more of our podcasts and information about our terms of use, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts.
All right, folks, I think we'll get started. Thanks very much for coming. It's the Craft of Teaching workshop on teaching with fiction. I will introduce our speakers in just a moment, but first just a couple of announcements. We have two more Craft of Teaching workshops this quarter. One of them, unfortunately, is already full, but I want to tell you about it anyway because we've got more of them coming up in the spring. That will be the micro-teaching workshop, an opportunity for students to present short, contained pieces of pedagogy, whether that's lecturing or group discussion, and then have feedback and actually get to workshop those components of teaching. The one for this quarter, again, is filled up, but keep your eyes peeled, and that will be by RSVP in winter and spring. The other event is coming up on November 13th at 9 a.m. in the Marty Center Library, and it's a philosophy of teaching statement workshop, which I realize is probably more useful for those of you towards the end of the process, the end of the Yellow Brick Road. But I think it should be fascinating for everybody. And now that the Craft of Teaching program has instituted a new capstone requirement of a draft or polished philosophy of teaching statement, it's a great workshop to be able to attend. We will do that annually. So today our speakers are first Lucy Pick, whom many of you will know, senior lecturer in the Divinity School and director of religious studies major in the college. And also, if there's any way you haven't yet heard, author of a work of historical fiction named Pilgrimage, which is top of my winter fiction reading list. Mm-hmm. Very much looking forward to it. So no spoilers, please.
No spoilers.
And we also have Noah Toly, who's associate professor of politics and international relations at Wheaton College, and a former senior fellow in our Marty Center. So I guess without further ado, I'll hand it over to you both. Thank you so much.
Great, thank you. I think we're going to divide the time up. I'll talk first, and Professor Toly will talk second, and then we'll have some time for questions. So I would appreciate it.
If anyone needs copies of the syllabi, they are here.
Yeah. So first of all, a disclaimer. I am in no wise a literary scholar. I didn't even take a literature class in college. So, you know, my days of formally studying literature are way back in high school. So I don't know how to approach a text in a classroom, like a fictional text, the same way that somebody who's skilled in pedagogy or fiction would do it. So what I say here today may not mean all that much to the prospective English professor or even to the would-be religion and literature professor. I'm kind of talking today to the rest of us, those of us who are not from those areas, who do not have literature as their profession, as their calling, but who still might want to use fiction in the classroom. That's the group I'm addressing. And I think the first question is, why might people like us want to use literature in the study of religion? What do we get out of it? And then second, how we might do it. So to answer the second part of the question, I've given you two syllabi that I'm going to discuss a little bit in brief, and I've given you a little bit of an extract from one of the texts I'm using for the second syllabus. So I'm going to talk about those things. But first, I'm going to talk about why you might want to use religion and why you might want to use fiction in a religious studies classroom in a class that is not a class about literature, that is to say. And these are my answers, and these are not the only answers, obviously. So I'll confess at the outset that my approach to making a syllabus is a highly intuitive, creative, non-linear process. I feel very comfortable when I construct the syllabus, putting something on it that I really want to have be there, even if I don't really know why at the time it belongs there. I just feel like I want to teach that text, and this is the class to teach it in, and juxtapose it with these other things, and they fit according to some logic that I'm not entirely aware of. I do think that I allow myself to do this, and I trust myself in doing this, partly because it's worked in the past. I do think that if the process of earning a PhD does anything for you, several things for you, but I think what it does, one of the things it does, is it trains your gut to identify what is important before the rest of you is taught. So what I'm going to say about why I use fiction in the classroom are more things I learned after teaching these syllabi, not the motivations that went into creating them. It wasn't like, how am I going to use fiction in the classroom? Well, what do I want to get out? You know, the way you're so told, have a goal. My goal in using fiction in the classroom is X, and so where's the novel that will fulfill that goal? That was not the way I approached this at all. So why use it? University classes about religion are necessarily, to a very large degree, confined by text. We are a texting place. We are a reading and learning culture here in the university. The texts are the primary sources of the religions we study in all their variety and complexity. We can, and do often, supplement these texts with objects, with aural experiences, the things that our students can hear and video. But there will still be a lot of gaps in what a student is capable of understanding religion to be. What is the power of a religious text or a religious idea for someone who is not you? How does it challenge that other person who takes this on as part of himself to behave in particular ways? These are things that it's hard to learn from text. But I think fiction, which itself is a text, obviously, a different kind of text, and I think fiction is designed precisely to fill these kind of gaps in our effective understanding of why people think the way they do, what they act the way they do, what they do. So I can read the Quran with students. I can send the students off to a mosque and say, describe what it is that you see. Can they understand what it feels to be a Muslim, a particular Muslim? The answer is probably no. They will know more by doing those things than they have done before. But is there something else that they can learn, and is there another way that I can teach it to them? I think fiction can express those effective aspects of religion by creating links between us and the characters and the stories that we read. Our story, reader's story, becomes linked to the story in the text. I'm sure a religion and literature person can explain this in a much better way than I can, but that is how this historian understands this process. Understanding how people I don't know feel when they feel religious is actually the reason why I like fiction. So that's, you know, it's part of that process that desire to fill that gap between what I could know from the academic material that I have to work with and what I could imagine a real life felt to be lived was why I wanted to write fiction. It kind of filled for me that way of understanding about how medieval people feel. So, on to the syllabi. I gave you two syllabi. The first, well, not first in order, but the first one I'm going to talk about, because I'm going to put it in reverse order, is the Tolkien medieval and modern syllabus. I'm not going to talk about it in any great detail. I'm not going to go through it section by section. But I'm happy to answer the questions. This syllabus I developed with Professor Rachel Fulton in the history department. And we taught it together, I think, in 2005. And she's continued to teach this course on her own a couple more times. And I don't teach it with her anymore. But this is the syllabus that we originally taught. We both had one of these kind of intuitions of, we want to teach a class in the Lord of the Rings. And we don't know why. And we don't really know what we want to do with it, except we know we're not literature professors. So we're not going to treat it as a work of literature. So what is it that we're going to do with it? We both felt a little bit insecure. We kept waiting for the knock on the door from somebody in the department saying, hey, wait a minute, you can't teach this. And maybe even worse, you know, this isn't an important enough text to be taught at this school. What kind of course were we going to do that was not the Lord of the Rings as literature and was not even the other thing we would have been entitled to do as medievalists, which is sort of the medieval Tolkien, you know, put Tolkien in his medieval context. We read a lot of the material that you read to do that. We read the Monster Critics and we read some of the things. But that's not what the course was about. It wasn't what it was intended to be. So what was it intended to be? Now, of course, with two different professors, you have two different sets of unspoken interests in teaching your class. And Professor Holden and I do have very different interests. I think our main common interest that was reflected throughout the syllabus was the idea of the relationship between capital C creation, cosmology, world building, world creation in its most obvious sense, and the idea of the author's sub-creation within that world, a sort of a making inside of that making. And this is something that Tolkien discusses in the Hoya, which is the poem we begin with at the outset of the class. It's a subject that still really interests me. I'd really like to teach a class someday that's sort of part religious studies, part creative writing, that talks about world building. I mean, that's, it's a major part of, not so much of contemporary realist literature, although there's elements of it in there too, but definitely, historical fiction, fantasy fiction, science fiction, you're building this world, but you're building this world inside another world. And what are the ethics of building a world? I think that's a question that really interests me, and I think it's something that interested Tolkien too, so that was part of what we got out of it. We also used, for the kind of sub-creation idea, Dorothy Sayers' book, The Mind of the Maker, several chapters from that, and she talks about the ethics of sub-creation. I was also interested in the way that Tolkien's text seemed to invite being read in the same way that medieval people read texts. That is to say, The Lord of the Rings seemed to invite or even demand an ethical reading in the medieval sense that read the letter of the text via an allegory, which was not the simple allegory of, the ring equals the atomic bomb, which is the reading that Tolkien himself condemns, but rather a kind of medieval Christian allegorization of the kind that Henri de Lubac discusses, in which you read the letter of the text through the allegory to understand the purpose of the text for you in your own life. In an odd conceit that did somehow seem to work, we read The Lord of the Rings the way we thought medieval people would have read The Lord of the Rings. So very much, very counterintuitive at this moment. Paying attention to language, names, trees, jewels, monsters, death, all of these subjects that capture medieval imagination. And you can see these reflected in the topics. Now, our final assignment, I would laugh at myself at this point. We thought we were so original. Let's get them to perform their own act of sub-creation. They can write something off of this Lord of the Rings universe. Friends, we had never heard of fan fiction. So we reinvented fan fiction. But that's what we got them to do. And they loved it. Or maybe they loved it because they found something online and handed it in. It was very easy for them. Whatever. They did phenomenal work. And what we discovered through this is that there is this huge sort of void in the university curriculum in which students are allowed to create something and to make something. And this helps to just give people a little bit of a taste of that, of being allowed to be creative, to make something in relationship to another text. And we had a group of people. We had also at the end of the class we had what we called a happening, which was sort of a big party. One group of students, one of the students wrote a play. It was a Hobbit play about the elves. So she had to do the kind of the Hobbit voice of the way elves would act, and then a bunch of her friends performed the play at the same. I mean, they were incredibly, they took this poem and they just ran with it. So that was great. So I do like the idea of teaching a single text, a single meaty text that you can kind of bounce off of different sorts of ideas. One syllabus I have an idea for, I haven't taught yet, would be to take Sigurd Undset's Kristin Lavrin's Daughter and use that as the framework for teaching a religion and society in a religious class. Take primary texts that relate to, you know, this is a novel about 14th century Scandinavia, and take historical accounts that talk about the things that are in the novel, you know, marriage, the Black Death, the church, folk culture, all of these things, and sort of read them in relationship to this novel. So I have other ideas for things like that. But the second syllabus that I want to talk about is the religion and gender syllabus that's here. It's a little bit shorter. This one I taught twice. The first time it was a roaring success. The second time it was not so successful, but it's just one of those things, I think. I don't know whether it was that I taught it at 9 in the morning the second time instead of 1-3. But it's interesting. If I'd done it the other way around, I would have assumed it was my fault. But it can't be entirely my fault. So if this is a course on religion and gender. So if an introduction to religious studies is a hard course to imagine teaching, an introduction to religion and gender is in fact actually twice as hard. Which may be why when I was looking for syllabi to model my course after, I was like, oh, well, you know, this will be easy to teach religion and gender. There's going to be a million syllabi out there on nothing, not one. You can find women in ex-religion syllabi. You can, you know, all over the place. You can find gender in ex-religion syllabi a little bit more. But the problem with the religion and gender syllabus is that you're taking two things that have been naturalized, the idea of religion and the idea of gender, and you're putting both of them in question at the same time. And there's no secure ground to stand on. That's what makes it hard to teach. It also is what I think makes it important to teach and why these two concepts put together are really productive. But it leaves not a lot of a solid ground on which a student may stand, and I think in some ways a narrative, what I hope is that the narrative of the novel helps to provide some of that familiarity, some of that continuity. So in a long ago graduate student workshop on how to teach an introductory course in religious studies, it's actually a student here, Alan F. Weaver, proposed using this book, The Girl in the Tangerines, for an intro to religious studies. I was curious by his discussion of the novel, and I read it and enjoyed it, and decided it would actually be perfect for religion and gender class. It would be good for an intro to religious studies class too. It's a story written by Mohra Kaf, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. She is a Syrian-American woman of about my age, about Kadra Shami, a Syrian-American woman who also would be about my age if she was a real person. Kadra's parents have fled the Ba'ath regime and settled eventually in Indianapolis, where her father becomes a leader in the local Islamic education center. So it's a novel about being Muslim in America in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. But even more, it's also about being a woman in America in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And even more, it's a book about religion. And the same period. And I use the novel a few ways in the class. So looking at the syllabus and passage that I've given you for a moment. Once again, I ask the students to read the whole novel as soon as possible during the class. It's easy to read. It's not a challenge. And then what I do is I assign chunks where appropriate. And I mix them all up so that they fit the themes of the class. So we're not reading it in order. We're not going kind of, you know, the order of the book is not structuring the order of the class for the most part, a little bit. So the class is divided into three sections, basically. Well, four sections, really. Theories, origins, bodies, and veils. So we finish by talking about veils, and you can imagine, if you haven't read this novel, The Girl in the Tangerine Scarf, you know, it's a good way to end But the first extract that I, the little extract that I've given you from the novel is, it's the first thing we read from the novel. It's not actually the very beginning of the novel. It's page 8. There's actually a little chapter that comes beforehand. Interesting to note. And it hits we read it in the first class, the class on worldviews. So this is a section where we're talking about the way religions describe their own origins, the way they create their own world. So we read it alongside Genesis, and Genesis chapters 1 to 3, and the Quran, surahs 1 and 2. So two different kinds of creation accounts. We will then talk about the Genesis account in the following class. We also start talking about the sort of idea of the goddess and the idea of sort of alternate accounts of cosmologies. And we conclude the section looking at a debate about gender in Yoruba religion. So very different kind of perspective and parameters. So that's what that section is. So I don't know if you had a chance to read the first passage. You're guided here a little bit in what I'm getting out of it by my little notes in the margin. And I didn't realize the first time I read it, or maybe the second time I read it, but let's say the third time I read it, I realized that this is a creation account in this novel. That, you know, the first world Kaf to remember was square one. Kaf is nothing but obvious in her symbolism. They end up moving to 1492, comes a drive, falling timbers, housing complex. The first world she remembered is square one. And then we have the buildings, the playground, the grass. We have the creation of earth. The lawn is then watered by wonderful spigots that make a musical sound as they inch around. Chick, 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 chick. Then back. Mama, what is heaven? So we have the separation of the waters of heaven from the earth. And we have the introduction of the mother here first. And then we have something that Kaf is going to know is unfamiliar to the vast majority of her audience, a whole lot of words that are not in English. You learn the lines, you know. When you're on the swings, and when you're on the swings, you learn the lines of the Fatiha. And we have these lines in Arabic. Bisma Allahami Rahim, Alhamdu Lalila, I should get this reading from you. Rabbi Al-Alamin, Arhmani Rahim, Kadr Kalab. So what are these texts? So they're the first three verses of the first surah of the Quran. Roughly translated, the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful, all the praises be to Allah, the Lord of the Amin, the Lord of the Quran, the Lord of the universe, the most gracious, the most merciful. So this text is used, this text I think is interesting here because it renders what we're doing unfamiliar. I mean, we're in this very familiar world that we may be able to remember from our own suburban childhoods, you know, if we had them. And then it's rendered unfamiliar by this text. It's also a different way of thinking about beginnings. I mean, this is the way, you know, the first beginning we've had is the beginning that would be more familiar to us in the Judeo-Christian tradition. It's the Genesis beginning of the world. But this is the beginning of the Quran. This textual source is the beginning of the Quran. It's used also as the first verse of every surah. It's recited several times a day as part of daily prayers. The Fatiha is recited at the beginning of each unit of the daily prayers. It is also the first phrase, I understand, in the constitution of many Islamic countries. So it has a whole different kind of place here. Merciful and gracious are divine attributes. There are a series of words that are identified with God. And so then I ask the students, you know, what genre of text is this? Eliciting the notion that this is not narrative, it's not biography, it's not description, it's prayer. So it's another different way of being. And I ask them to tell me why Kaf uses it here, what's going on these first couple of pages. So that's just a little kind of example of how you can use something that's a sort of just a story, it's just a little tiny part of a story, as a way to think about how religion figures into this character's life and how religion figures into text. I use two different I use a number of different times, but I use two assignments that I think are interesting based on this book for this course. First, as you can tell from this passage, Kadra lives her life in a kind of an intertextual way, the same kind of intertextual way that a lot of religious people do. You know, we're different texts, and a lot of non-religious people do. It's hard to explain to somebody on the outside of religion, a particular religion or religion as a whole, what this means to live your life in relationship to a set of religious texts. Each of the chapters does what this one does and begins with a capstone quotation. This one is from the Psalms. The texts are from all over, from the not just from religious texts, but from everything from Leonard Cohen to Laura Ingalls Wilder. And so what I asked them to do for one of the assignments is to take one of these capstones, figure out what it's from, what it's doing there, and what it's doing in this text, why it was chosen to be used in this text. And then we have a discussion about it. We spend a whole class period and they talk about what's going on in these texts. The second is drawn from the book itself also. It is, again, an opportunity to write something of their own. They can do a research, conventional research paper, and I should actually say that both with the Tolkien class and with this class, I always want to give people an opportunity to do a conventional research paper. Not everybody wants to be autobiographical. Not everybody wants to do that kind of giving of themselves and having had memories of sort of high school religion classes when you get graded by how well you express your suffering soul. I really don't want to force anybody to do that. But they can also contribute to more personal writing. They can write a memoir themselves, or they can write memoir in the form of a story, which is basically what Kopp is doing here. And once again, I've had really, really great results in that kind of assignment. One of the questions people always ask is, how do I grade something like that? What I say is that both types of topics will be graded on the basis of how well they show an understanding and assimilation of the topics and meanings we've discussed in class, i.e. not how well you write or how interesting your life is, but how you're able to reflect on it in an intelligent way based on the things we've talked about. So, here we go.
Great. Thanks for those comments. I think I resonate with quite a few of them, and I'll start just by mentioning the Lord of the Rings syllabus. I just finished reading all of The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings aloud to my children, and it took me about 26 months. It took me 26 months, I was counting. And we took breaks in between books, and there were nights we didn't read. We probably averaged about 6 pages per night when we did read. But this ethical reading of it, this allegorical reading, as if we're reading for the ethical implications for ourselves, is actually something that we did the whole time. Mm-hmm. And it actually came really naturally to our children. And I suppose, as one of them gets old enough that he looks like he's one of my students whenever he's in the dining hall, that would actually resonate really well with students, too, for a lot of reasons. I also resonate with the intuitive and experimental approach to syllabus making. One of the reasons that I resonate with that is the risk-taking that's involved there. I want to encourage my students to take risks. And I mean intellectual risks. I mean risks in how they write. I mean risks in how they live their lives. And the choices that they make on a daily basis, and also the ones that are much more consequential about maybe what they're going to do when they graduate. And if I can't, I'm convinced, if I can't take risks in front of them, if I can't take risks in my own profession, then I'm not ever going to teach them how to do that. And I think that's true for most of us. And this is one of the ways that we do it. It seems like it doesn't matter a whole lot, but to be able to walk in and say, I don't know how this will go exactly. And it's not exactly the same thing that I did the last time. And it's a bit outside of our discipline, but we're going to take it on anyway and try this out. I think that's an important way to be able in front of them to do that. And I'm actually fairly transparent with them sometimes when I do. And then finally, the power of religion for someone who is not you is a way that you put it when it comes to what students can learn from fiction. I think that applies to a bunch of what I'll say when I get to the examples. I'm going to structure my own comments according to basically 3 major points: why I became interested or how I became interested in adding fiction to courses in fields that are largely not dealing with fictional texts, Number two, reasons to do this. Things that I've learned, mainly I've learned after having done it. That is, I didn't have all these reasons to do it before I did it. I learned what these reasons might be as I experimented with fiction. And then finally, a set of examples. So why I became interested. I had faculty members who did this in courses that I took. So I should say that one faculty member in Intro to Law, which was a political science course, assigned Lord of the Flies to begin that course. Very interesting approach. I know another faculty member who would love in that course, now that the faculty member who used to teach that is not there anymore, and the faculty member who teaches it now would love to assign Cormac McCarthy's Blood Meridian, but cannot bring himself to do it. Because there are passages, if you know the book, there are passages of it where no normal human being should want to continue reading. And he's afraid how undergraduates will take that. Another faculty member assigned Looking Backward by Edward Bellamy in a doctoral pro seminar on urban governance, planning, and management. Looking Backward, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, is a 20th century century utopian text, utopian socialist text. And this was a great way to begin that course. And then in a seminar I took on religion and scholarship, Marilyn Robinson's Gilead, which was very different from the other two. And I actually wasn't a big fan of how that text was used in that seminar, but there will be, I think, similarities between how that text was used and the work that it was doing and the work that I expect the text to do now in my own courses that I didn't even realize until I started preparing these remarks. And you'll note that the first two are utopian and dystopian texts, right? Looking Backward is a utopian text. Lord of the Flies is a classical dystopian text. And Gilead is not either of those. And it turns out that all of my best uses of fiction in class have been not utopian or dystopian texts. So the examples, we'll come back to the differences there in a minute. But what did the work, especially with Lord of the Flies and Looking Backward, what work did they do in those classes? Number one, they captured the imaginations of students. Number two, they presented, in some ways, the stakes. They presented the stakes of the discussion. Number three, they actually helped students to envision possibilities. And there's a classic use of utopian and dystopian literature in scenario projecting. In fact, there's a whole new use of what's called cli-fi, climate fiction, in class, which is largely about scenario projecting and motivating people politically. Those texts are useful that way. That doesn't happen to be how I use texts. Again, we'll come back to that in a minute. So what are some reasons to do this? And keep in mind, I teach undergraduates at a liberal arts college. This might work differently in other contexts. I teach undergraduates at a liberal arts college where, unfortunately, many of the students don't know what liberal arts are until we really get into that with them. And sometimes that comes too late. But a lot of them are more rather than less open to this approach. They have required courses in literature. They have required courses in writing. And that's not true at every undergraduate institution. So one reason is to introduce themes, questions, and tensions that are key to the course. Themes, questions, and tensions. I think novels are especially good at this, introducing themes, questions, and tensions. They're especially good at presenting complexity, presenting students with ambiguities and with ambivalence that they may not be used to, and we're not necessarily used to teaching in, let's say, social science courses, where most of my courses are. Another reason is to make the familiar strange. I find that this is really important right off the bat in a whole lot of courses. My students, I love where I teach. In fact, I'm an alum of Wheaton College. But a lot of Wheaton students come to every class thinking they already know the material. And one of the things that we need to do with them right in the beginning, if we can, is to make what they think is familiar very strange to them. And I'll come back to that with the politics and technology syllabus and with DeLillo, and I think how DeLillo works to do that. A third reason is to introduce or suggest postures toward the world or toward the course or scholarship that I think are important for the student to take. And I'll come back to that with the Baxter example. But to introduce or suggest postures toward the world or toward the course. So let's get into some examples here. In environmental politics, I haven't actually brought any examples of that to speak about those. I have been tempted to use, for example, Paolo Bacigalupi's The Wind-Up Girl. I don't know if any of you know The Wind-Up Girl. I think it could be helpful in lots of ways. I think it's also problematically misogynistic in certain parts, and it's unclear whether or not Bacigalupi has a sufficiently critical angle on that himself. So I have stayed away from it for that reason, but I've also stayed away from it for this reason. The fact that I find utopian and dystopian literature doing the kind of work I'm not as interested in doing in class, that is projecting scenarios and motivating political stances or positions. What I'm more interested in doing in the class is exactly what I mentioned with point number one above, which is introducing questions, introducing tensions, introducing complexities, ambiguities, and even ambivalence into the classroom. I want them from the beginning to understand how very difficult a lot of the questions we're asking are in environmental politics, how fraught they are. And so what I've had luck with in, and I say luck because I just picked them and threw them into a syllabus at the last minute, the last time I taught, and they worked. Are Gabriel Garcia Marquez's 100 Years of Solitude and Aeschylus, part of the Libation Bearers. So for those of you who know Aeschylus, or know the Libation Bearers at all, you know that Orestes faces this terrible choice. His mother has killed his father so that she and his father's cousin can rule together. Should they have an adulterous relationship, and they can continue that relationship and rule together after his death. And Orestes is pressed into vengeful matricide. If he doesn't commit this murder, if he doesn't kill his mother, then Zeus will hold him accountable for not actually avenging his father's death. And if he does, then the Furies will actually pursue him, which they do eventually to Athens. It's a lose-lose situation. A situation in which, as Orestes himself says, right collides with right. Now, I was put onto this to bring a religious angle explicitly into it at this point. I was put onto this by reading in Bonhoeffer's Ethics, where Bonhoeffer cites Aeschylus and actually cites Orestes' cry, right collides with right. And it struck me that this captured something important about what I want my students to think regarding environmental politics, or what I want them to think about, the problems and tensions I want them to think within and face. And so that's one of the texts that has worked really well. Moving on to another course, there is my Advanced Urban Studies seminar, the Capstone in Urban Studies. And in that course, I haven't ever found a book that has worked particularly well. So I'll give a little bit of background. I haven't found ones that have been total failures, but I haven't found any that I wanted to stick with for a second time. I opened with Joseph O'Neill's Netherland. Tried that and found that it did not capture students' imaginations particularly well. It's a post 9/11 book about a let's say, a Dutch person who is a Dutch immigrant in the United States who learns to play cricket in the United States, and which is interesting that he learns to play cricket in the United States from other immigrants in the United States. But he also is trying to figure out his posture toward the world, whether he's going to take a more cosmopolitan posture or not toward the world. It's a very interesting book. It didn't work really well with my students, and so I moved on to Teju Cole's Open City for that course to open it up. Also very interesting. Students enjoyed the read, but it didn't really fit with the class. And so I'm moving on to Colin McCann's Let the Great World Spin. We will see how this works. The reason that I've chosen it is because I've decided that the theme for this year's capstone course in urban studies will be the relationship between religious institutions and their urban environments. And there's an incredible amount of great scholarship on that point, from anthropology and sociology of religion, done by historians, sometimes done by theologians. Let the Great World Spin will allow me to ask this very same question: what is the power of religion for someone who is not you, vis-a-vis this interaction with urban environments? And I don't know whether or not students will actually take to that with this text, but we'll find out more in January. I also, in that same class, use Charles Baxter's Through the Safety Net, which I think you had printed for today, or at least available online. And I assigned that with a chapter from C. Wright Mills, The Sociological Imagination. Some of you may know Mills. Mills' point in his opening chapter, which is called The Promise, is that in order to rightly do sociological work or rightly do sociology, we have to understand the intersection of biography and history, of individual and collective, of personal and social. Those are the ways that he puts it. We have to be able to see how those are woven together, to see the individual in the collective, or see how the collective affects the individual, to see how the biography, the individual life lived, and how we can write it, intersects with history. And what I think that the Baxter story does is it invites us to ask questions about that exact relationship, the inside and the outside. The woman in the story gets bad news, those of you who've read it, she gets bad news from her fortune teller, who can't tell her exactly what's going to happen, doesn't know what will go wrong, but does know something will go very wrong. And this woman thinks that it's all about herself, or maybe it's about her husband. Maybe it's about her husband. She's not able to conceive, for most of the story, of the possibility that something might be wrong with the whole world, that something might actually go wrong with the whole world. So at the end of the story, what she realizes is she finally looks outside her window, outside the window of her home, contemplates what's outside, and understands what may be going on. What the work that I want to do with that text is introduce students to two things. I want to introduce them in another way to this point that Mills is making. And I want to introduce them to a posture they maybe ought to take toward with the course. A lot of our students immediately want to make the course about themselves. They immediately want to ask questions, well, how exactly do I fit into this? And I don't want to keep them from that. But I do want to chasten that. I do want them to be looking out beyond our walls, out beyond themselves, and be considering the world that they just come in from, as most of them are coming from spending a semester in an experiential program that I run. And then finally, I'll use the example of Don DeLillo's White Noise. You have the syllabus for that.
Syllabus is somewhere here. We didn't get that out in time.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't actually get here very early myself. So in my politics of technology course, I assigned 7 texts, no, 6, starting with Don DeLillo's White Noise, and moving forward through Lewis Mumford, Jacques Ellul, Langdon Winner, Matthew Patterson's Automobile Politics, and then David Noble's The Religion of Technology. And what I'm doing here is making the familiar strange. I think our students come to us, especially with regard to technology, with a lot of familiarity. They come to us with a lot of familiarity, and it's of two sorts, right? They think they know what kind of technology the course might be about. Also, they think that we all have such an intimate relationship with technology that we make assumptions about it all the time, and our students are not excluded from that. They make assumptions about this all the time. What I think that DeLillo can do for us here, especially because it's not dystopian literature, is make technology strange for us again. The watches we're wearing, the phones we're carrying around, the trains that run down the tracks, the smoke that issues from the cars, the station wagons that people drive up in the beginning of the story, the schools that we go to, the education that we have as a sort of technique. I think that DeLillo makes that strange precisely because of the various absurdities in the book that are set in a more or less contemporary world. So what I want to do with that text is introduce them not only to certain themes and questions, not only to how the characters are dealing with questions that technology presents to them, but also to make that familiar strange. So I think I want to mention before we get a couple of hidden benefits to this, hidden benefits to including literature in your courses, or fiction in your courses, and this is just from my perspective, I'm sure there are many others that people could mention. Number one is collaboration. So I've actually taught some of these texts in collaboration with colleagues. When I happen to be starting DeLillo with a half semester course, we have some courses at Wheaton that are half semester, which means they're a little shorter than your quarters. They're really, really hard to teach, in my opinion. They're about 7 or 8 weeks, and that's hard to pack some things into, especially politics and technology. So we were starting DeLillo in March at the beginning of the course, and a colleague of mine in literature who was teaching American literature was teaching DeLillo in the middle of the semester too. So we brought our classes together and co-led that session. That was very fruitful collaboration. We hope to actually make more of it down the road. And the students got more out of it. Her students got more out of it. I've done a lot of work on politics and technology, or technology policy, technology and ethics. And my students got more out of it because they actually had a literature professor in the classroom that session. Another way that I've benefited from it is just the collegiality that comes from asking people to help me understand this text or help me understand how I can teach it really well. I've actually, on more than one occasion, invited over a number of colleagues I think would give a close reading of the text or have already done close readings of the text. Some of them are literature professors, and I've said, I'll buy the beer, we'll talk about the book, you help me understand it, and I'll teach it a whole lot better. And that has worked out really well, too. I've learned a lot, and I've actually taught those sessions better because of it. So those are my comments. Why I became interested, reasons to do it that I learned only after trying it out, examples, things that have worked and things that have not, and the hidden benefits of connecting with colleagues who can help you with it. Thanks.
So we have 25 minutes for discussion, so plenty of time to get into the issues in the syllabi, in the stories. The one that we had available for people was McCann's With All Respects to Heaven, so I'm not sure, maybe there
was some issues. It was available.
Was it available as well? My mistake.
Yeah, the safety net was also there.
Got it, okay.
So then, yeah, anything in stories as well, I mean, shall we you to open up the discussion?
Sure. Discussion is open.
Yeah.
So have you experimented with whim in the term?
You read fiction. So it sounds like you open the class with this most frequently. Have you ever read a novel or something else at the end of the term?
Most of the times I've done it, I've actually required basically the Lord of the Rings they had to read before they
right,
got to the class.
Yeah, that's the class. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And this other novel, I had them, you know, they also had to read it early on, so it ends up. Yeah. But it's interesting what would happen if you read it at the end.
Yeah, I actually haven't experimented with when I've placed them all in the beginning, but actually having heard about the girl in the tangerine scarf and how you use that, I may just ask them to read it in the beginning and then revisit it, mm-hmm. which is one thing I've only required before in assignments, but we've never done in discussion. Actually, that's not fair. We've done it in discussion in the sense that I've asked students to lead discussion or co-lead discussion, been part of the course requirements. And in those cases, I have asked them to make connections back. So for example, make connections back to DeLillo when it comes to politics and technology. It doesn't end up being the only thing they're doing. And it may not always be a very heavy dose of connections back. But it would be interesting to sort of spread it out.
I have a question for each of you, actually. Dr. Pick, I was wondering with the assignment of doing a creative work, how much instruction you give them and how much feedback, if any, on drafts and as they're putting this together. Mm-hmm. And then, Dr. Toly, I was curious, you talked a lot about sort of the pedagogical takeaway that the students you hope are getting mm-hmm. from some of these mm-hmm. readings, and I'm wondering, how transparent are you with the students about what this is meant to teach them? And I know that you're open to all kinds of things that they may be drawing out of it, but it also seems like you have a very clear idea of what kind of a tone this will set for their own learning process mm-hmm. and so forth. And I'm wondering how you see if they're getting that mm-hmm. and how you kind of lead them to that.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Mm-hmm. I don't give feedback on drafts for the most part. I'll do that sometimes for some classes, but I don't usually do that. So in terms of what kind of instruction I give them, first, I think having the other option to not do it gives them a freedom to allow themselves to do it. I mean, almost none of them don't do it, but I think knowing that they could do the thing that's conventional allows them to do the thing that's more complicated. What I do with this class, I think primarily the novel itself becomes a model. And so I will talk about it in a constructive, you know, how is it being constructed as we're talking about it. Look at what she's doing here, you know, look at how this is described. We also read an article in the veiling section called Spare Me the Sermon on Muslim Women, and it's by Koff speaking for herself. You know, and so there's a kind of, they're able to see that double voice of the author as fiction writer and the author as essayist. And it's a slightly different voice, you know, you can kind of see the differences. The other thing that we read, in the section on bodies is an article that I love and I use it in my intro of religious studies class by Icarve on the Road, a Maharashtrian pilgrimage. You can see how the title On the Road connects to another famous fictional American text. Really interesting article published in 1962. It is both a description of the pilgrimage to Maharashtra from a kind of anthropological, sociological perspective, but it's also her as a woman and an Indian and an anthropologist and a religious person going on this pilgrimage. She's inside it, she's outside it. So one of the things we talk about in that class is, again, how she kind of, the relationship of herself to this account that she gives. So those are the ways I model possibilities for them and the difficulties and complexities of doing something.
That's a great question about transparency with students, about your purposes or goals. You know, if it's something that we want them to get about content, this is obviously something where eventually we want to be entirely transparent. On the other hand, if it's something that if it's a posture we want them to take, not being transparent can seem manipulative, but being transparent can have its problems too. And so I think what you want is the best of both worlds. And I try to have the best of both worlds by having them do some sort of short writing assignment in class when we're dealing with those texts, right up front. Maybe it's 5, 10, 12 minutes of writing, and then asking what they learned from the text. And making connections and helping them to move through the conversation or discussion to the point where they all understand what the text can do to them, or do for them, rather. Do for them in the context of the class. And I think eventually, I usually get to the point where I say, yeah, that's one of the reasons that we're actually considering this text. That's one of the reasons that we're reading Baxter. Mm-hmm. That's one of the reasons that we read it with notes, something like that. But I don't want to do that right up front. I think it's much more valuable if most of them can come to that conclusion together. And then I wouldn't want to completely lose the students who aren't seeing that. And so I help them help each other to see it before we're done. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm.
This is primarily a question for you, Professor Pitt. I know that you said that you sort of choose these texts sometimes by gut, but I'm wondering, and you've already sort of alluded to this, but I guess I'd like to have a little more.
Sure.
How much of your own selection of texts or the choosing of text itself is a reflection of your understanding of religion as a phenomenon?
Well, in theory, it should be all of my choosing of text. I don't know if I have a single understanding of religion as a phenomena against which, you know, that I could use as a kind of a beacon. Mm-hmm. So I think that, I really like what Professor Toly says about making the familiar strange. I think another thing that part of it's about that. Mm-hmm. Part of it's about making the strange familiar, mm-hmm. too. You know, these are twin aspects, and what is strange and what is familiar in a different educational context will be very different. I imagine what is familiar at Wheaton is not necessarily what's familiar to classroom here, is not familiar at, you know, University of Illinois, Chicago. So it has less to do with some kind of stable object of religion and more with that unstable quality of where the students are and where they meet religion. I think. Mm-hmm. It's not a very satisfying answer, maybe, because it means that, you know, every soul is in every school will be different. But I think that's the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for a religion class.
Yeah.
I think religion is unusual in that respect. It's not as transferable from institution to institution.
Mm-hmm. If I could follow up on that, mm-hmm. I think that's exactly right. Sometimes it's making the familiar strange. Sometimes it's making the strange familiar. You really have to know your students very well in order to know. And it may not mean you know those 18 students or those 10. Sometimes it does. I'm going to get you an example of where it does. But it means knowing your context, knowing what kinds of students you have, what they may need from you when it comes to the role of literature in class. I have sometimes assigned through the safety net and paired it not only with Mills, but also with a scene from Insomnia, the movie. Mm-hmm. Christopher Nolan directed it. Robin Williams and Al Pacino starred in it. And Robin Williams was a serial killer in that movie. And I actually appreciate Robin Williams' more serious roles more than I do his comedy, actually. And I thought it was a fantastic film. But in it, sorry for the spoiler, Al Pacino plays a homicide detective from Los Angeles who's brought up to Alaska. It's a night view to Alaska, where the sun is not going down at all during that season, in order to help investigate these serial killings. And in a fog, he shoots and kills his partner, also a homicide detective from Los Angeles who's brought up for that purpose. Nobody else knows that he's done this except himself and Robin Williams. And Robin Williams' character calls him up and basically torments him about this throughout the rest of the movie. And Al Pacino can't sleep. His detective character can't sleep. Now, he thinks it's because the sun's not going down. So he papers over the hotel windows. He puts all kinds of things up in his room in order to make it as dark as possible. And he still can't sleep. What the problem is inside in that case and not outside. And so this is a really interesting pairing with Baxter. And then when you're also reading Mills, can be really fruitful if you all put these together. Sometimes I've had a group of students and thought, actually, they really need right now, because I know these 12 students who are in this class, they really need Part of Insomnia paired with Baxter this session. And we're going to talk about how the things that are concerning them, sometimes these are really problems that are interior, not exterior. So let's deal with that, or make the tension even clearer to them, even harder to deal with in some ways. I don't want any easy problems. I want problems that are going to take at least 8 weeks to deal with, and probably the rest of their lives. And we can only set this up. And I think that works really well. But I have to know them in order to do that.
And those are students you have from your experiential?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's why I know them well.
So in some ways, there you are introducing fiction later on in the class.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's true. Because
it's later on in your time with them.
Yeah, it's a carryover. That's exactly right. Even if it's the beginning of a certain course, it's carried over. Those relationships are carried over. The cohort is the same. They've been doing some other things together.
Thank you for your presentations. I'm teaching philosophical hermeneutics at Wheaton College this semester, and the main chunk of the class is reading Gadamer's Truth and Method, which, when you chunk it up, is about 16 weeks of the class. It's a 16-week class. I really wanted to assign Jane Austen for this course because I think she does such an interesting job exploring prejudices and how they're helpful and hurtful, and Gadamer does the same thing, but it's a long book. And I didn't feel like I could ask the students to read that whole book in the 2 weeks that we would have for other texts. And I'm wondering what each of you might have done in that situation. I really wanted to assign it, but I wanted to assign the whole thing. I didn't really want to just assign a section of it. Would you have maybe done that? I ended up not assigning a fictional text. I assigned something else. But I really wanted to, but I didn't find a way how to do it. How might you have approached it?
Well, the way we did it with The Lord of the Rings, and it probably helps maybe if you're part of the institution and you can go right into the catalog, you know, at the beginning of the year. It's a spring class, so they were able to see if they're going to take this class, they have to have read all The Lord of the Rings. We taught it, I think the first movie was out, but maybe not all the movies were out. And our big fear was that they'd see the movie, you know, they'd see the movies. So we actually had a quiz on the first day. I have some question marks about the quiz, but that could be one way. You know, that can be one way.
Okay.
Of making sure they've
read it. If I did Kristen Lambert's Daughter too, I would also say you have to read it before you come to class. I mean, it's this thick. I mean, you know, if you want to really use a text in relate that's not. It's not a course about discovering the text. Mm-hmm. You really, in a way, have to have it early on beforehand. I think that is one of the challenges. Mm-hmm. But you know, that's what you're doing for your spring break.
Yeah. I think, in terms of making sure that they read, and you mentioned spring break, that's a great point. Making sure that they read, quizzes are very helpful. I think when it comes to breaks, I would have perhaps, and I know you probably weren't in this position, given that you may have found out later in the summer that you were teaching this.
I did.
Yeah. So if it had been very early in the summer, or even let's say spring registration time, they registered in March or April, I would not hesitate to put Pride and Prejudice on that syllabus. Contact everybody who's registered, and say, it may be a way to get a smaller class too. But maybe drop a class. But I'd say, you know, you're expected to read this before the first day. And then they have the whole break to do it. I've done that with spring break, I've done that with Christmas break, and I've done that with summer. No student has ever come in saying, I can't believe you made me read that novel over the break. And that's good, that's really good, because we have wonderful students. They are really eager to see what we're going to do in class, and they want to know it early. They want to be doing that work. But that's an awfully long book, and they might have needed more time than you had.
Mm-hmm.
Lucy, I heard you say at Wednesday lunch that you like to read historical fiction as well as write it.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if you have ever taught using historical fiction, and the reason I ask is that it seems to raise questions about the relationship between truth and fiction that I would like to explore in early Christian texts that we sort of just call narratives and get around the whole question of whether they're true, you know, they're true text or fiction or
Bible. Yeah, things like the Acts of the Apostles, like the Acts of Paul and that kind
like
of thing.
Like the Apocryphal Acts or things like that. Yeah. So I'm wondering, you know, trying to envision a way where maybe historical fiction could get into those.
Could get into doing that. I mean, I'm actually teaching this class on virginity right now, and so we're reading Paul Thecla, and we're reading also Kay Cooper's book, where she connects these to the Greek story. So I don't know if that's one way. I mean, that's not my turf at all. But I don't know whether actually doing the kind of primary source work that she did for that book and reading them in relationship to these Greek narratives, I don't even know if they can translate it, would be one good way to go. But that's, I've never used historical fiction text in a class. And that's why I'm interested in doing the Kristen Lovin's daughter. Because as I was reading that, I thought, this woman's history is good enough that I could assign this, and I feel comfortable. I feel comfortable with the level, you know, of work that she's done to create this text. The narrative is historically plausible. Is historically plausible enough that it would work? I mean, that's the challenge: is finding the right. The more you know, the more historical fiction doesn't work. So it's a question of finding the right text. I can imagine teaching, you know, this would be a class so much on religion. Well, it could be a class so much on religion. Teaching, you know, a tutor English class with Hilary Mantel's Will Paul, for instance, because I think that there she makes a historically interesting argument by Thomas Cromwell and Cardinal Wolsey based on the background of this. Or a class on, I took a class as a graduate student on the Northern Renaissance, and that novel would work perfectly in relationship with that. So for all my knowledge of Charlotte, so I think that there are ways to, also it's a question of finding, you know, you've got to find a novel that to you as a scholar is rich enough and powerful enough.
So this was really interesting for me because I just literally 2 weeks ago defended my dissertation, which compares the ways Turkish and Arab nationalism work in historical fiction at the beginning of the 20th century. So my main actually dream is to teach with fiction mainly. So that's my, you know how when you apply to jobs, they ask you like, what is your dream course or something like that. So that is my dream course, especially Turkey and Egypt, like modern Turkish and Arab.
Did you work with Professor Ashdeen, I think?
I'm in NALC,
yeah,
modern Middle Eastern history. I was working with Professor Schisler and Professor Batch.
Did you ever talk to Professor Ashdeen? Because I think she told me about somebody who was writing a dissertation.
Yeah, probably me.
Yeah,
so, and I, like you, I'm not a literature person. Yeah. I'm approaching the texts from a history perspective. Yeah. I mean, I'm historical, modern Middle Eastern historian. So the question that I have is also for myself. Were there moments in your teaching when you felt like, oh my God, I'm lacking in literary theory or, you know, comparative literature, all these, you know, theoretical classes that I didn't take, basically. Did you kind of feel like there was something that you needed to brush up on while teaching these texts? Are there recommendations regarding?
You know, that's, you know, you've hit precisely what Professor Fulton and I were worried about, I think, as we, you know, before we talked to Fulton class. And it wasn't a problem, but I think it may depend on the kind of works that you choose. If you choose the kind of things that are not likely to be taught in a literature class, then you're less likely to attract the kind of student who already has that sort of vocabulary, frankly, you know, just to be honest. The religion and gender class, nobody was coming to it expecting to have sort of a sophisticated literary analysis. So I was able to talk about the text in the way I wanted to talk about it. rather. With the total class, we were, I mean, I think, you know, we had a great group with the kind of gist of what I think you're saying about being explicit and being honest with your students. We were very open about, you know, this is what this class is about, this is what it's not about, you know? So I think that if you're very clear about what you want to do. And in general, college students don't have a tremendously sophisticated, you know, I mean, they're just in the process of learning how to do this, and it's challenging for them, and if you come with some other way of reading, they're okay with that, even if they're doing work like that in some other class. You know, you have a lot of authority as a professor. I think that's worth remembering. It's hard to feel that way, you know, but you actually do have a lot of authority as a professor. And they will take, to a large extent, maybe too much for granted what it is that they're presenting.
We thank you for listening to or viewing our podcast. For more information and for other podcasts, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts. Copyright, the University of Chicago Divinity School.